So good morning, everyone. Good afternoon or good evening, whenever you're joining and from wherever you're joining. Namaste and Tashidele. So my name's Thubten Tempa, and I'm leading this session here at Tushita Meditation Center in Delhi. So welcome. So today we're going to be engaging in a Vajrayana practice. Which is supported by Mahayana motivation and the teachings of Mahayana, as well as the Hinayana. So Hinayana being the lowest lowest vehicle, lowest scope, being the scope of why we're seeking enlightenment, not that it's less superior, than the Mahayana. Is the great vehicle, great meaning, the implying the scope that we're seeking enlightenment for the benefit of all sentient beings, and then we also have the Vajrayana, which is also considered it's a Mahayana practice. So without the any of these, they all support from the bottom up each other. So. Just for the interest of the time that we have together today, I'll only be going through brief explanations of the practice that we're going to be doing. But if you have any more questions, then you feel free to write comments in when this is posted. If you're viewing in YouTube or in the chat, maybe I can answer some questions at the end after we finish. But also you can contact the center or visit the center here in Delhi if you do have any further questions or inquiries about anything that I mentioned that I don't give enough detail and you're more interested about. We should also always try to not be constrained by time in our practice of meditation or any meditation or Buddhist practices that we engage in. Of course, in today's modern world, that's not always possible. We should try the best, not be focused on time, just because that can hinder our practice and our focus in the session and the freedom that we feel at that time. And so just the best you can in day to day, just allow yourself freedom of time as much as you can. So let's just first settle into the place that we've chosen to, or that is available to us to do our practice, and to find a comfortable seat, whether that be a chair or a cushion on the floor, whichever's most conducive and most comfortable for you to complete the session without discomfort or as little discomfort as possible. And then just settle into your seated posture. Again, whichever is most comfortable for you. Usually, cross leg position is the most ideal. On a cushion on the floor. Or if you're sitting on a couch, you can sit in cross-leg position also. And just because this helps, this position is particularly beneficial to support our body and help us create a stability for our concentration. So just settle into that posture following the usual preliminary instructions, so the 7 points. So just making sure that our back is straight. Our head is also centered and well supported and corner angled slightly downwards. Our mouth and jaw relaxed but closed. not clenching our teeth. And our tongue should be just resting slightly up behind the teeth, behind the upper front teeth. And our arms just resting in our lap, the right palm over the left, with the thumbs just lightly, gently touching. And our elbows outwards, so that we have space under our arms. And then our legs crossed in, or in a comfortable position. If we're sitting in a chair, they should be at a right angle. Our knees should be bent at a right angle to the floor. Our feet should be flat on the floor, the hip distance. And if we are in a chair like myself, just sitting slightly forward, not resting at the back, and also not too near the front, that we're constantly feeling we're going to fall. And then just settle into your breathing. So we'll just first take three deep breaths in slowly. And out, slow and controlled, but deeply, making sure we fill all of our lungs from our lower, where our diaphragm is, up to the top of our chest, filling completely. And then just rest into your normal breathing pattern and rhythm. And just be aware either at your nostrils or at your chest of the inhalation and exhalation. You can follow the 9-point or the 9-round breathing technique that I demonstrated or instructed yesterday. It's a good way to neutralize and balance our awareness. And try to forget any thoughts or engagements. A thought that we had prior to this session, not necessarily related with our practice. Try to leave all worldly distractions and thoughts aside. Just being present in the moment and with your breath. So today, our object of meditation will be Thousand Arm Chenrezig in Tibetan. Chenrezig in Sanskrit, Avalokiteshvara. And in English, the Thousand-Eyed Looking One. or compassionate-eyed looking one. So Chen Rezig is the embodiment of all Buddha's compassion. Compassion meaning the wish to take all the suffering of numberless sentient beings without discrimination. And having loving kindness of the most imaginable, unimaginable scope, that unconditional love, which we can liken to that of a mother or her child. But in actuality, the loving kindness of Chinrezig goes far, far exceeds that. And so Chinrezig, Arya Avalokiteshvara, is a bodhisattva, someone who has accomplished high realizations. He's virtually completed the path. What has come and withstand from abiding in nirvana in order to abide in samsara for sentient beings in order to liberate us. So I will just show on the screen the visual of great compassionate Chinrezig. And so I will talk you through the visualization of Chinrezig. We can see here in the aspect having 1,000 arms. There's many, many said to be numberless aspects of Chinrezig. So this is the aspect of Chinrezig showing 1,000 arms. So I'll describe the visualization. And with some brief meaning included. But first, I'll just show you the text that we're going to be following, which I'll include links. I'll request to include the links to these texts if you wish to follow this practice in your own time and space, in the YouTube, in the comment, in the description. So this is called the ever-flowing nectar of bodhicitta. Bodhicitta meaning the mind of enlightenment. In particular, the mind of enlightenment, to achieve enlightenment for all sentient beings, which is the Mahayana motivation and scope. Annihilating the demon of the self-cherishing mind. So the self-cherishing mind is the complete antithesis of bodhicitta. And this was composed by Kapche Lama Tutun Zaburimche, who is the spiritual director of the FPMT organization. So I'm going to talk us through, guide us through the motivation first, and then we will do the visualization and continue the practice. Motivation is the most important aspect of Vajrayana practice because based on the mind of bodhicitta, mind of wishing to achieve enlightenment for all sentient beings is the basis of a Vajrayana practice. That's its distinct characteristic. Without bodhicitta, then whatever you engage in terms of Vajrayana, which is which in includes the tantric practices, is completely meaningless. So first, we must have some contrived feeling of bodhicitta, wishing to free all numberless sentient beings. So from beginningly beginningless rebirths up to now, We can think, I have experienced the general sufferings of samsara and the particular sufferings of the lower realms numberless times. There is no suffering that I have never experienced. When I think deeply about all this, I feel terribly upset and weep uncontrollably. Therefore, I must no longer allow myself to come under the control of the disturbing, unsubdued thoughts, which are the true causes that bring the result of true sufferings. As long as I happily continue to follow the disturbing, unsubdued minds of the wrong concepts, which is the concept of ignorance, grasping at self as being true and permanent, with neither fear nor doubt, there is no difference between me and a mindless, crazy person. If I continue to follow these wrong concepts, I will definitely have to experience the sufferings of samsara, cyclic existence, endlessly in future lives. When I think about this from the depths of my heart and not just reciting the words, I am unable to eat by day or sleep by night. And it makes me vomit. It also breaks my heart. So when we actually realize within our mind stream, even a glimmer of what bodhicitta really means, what it is in our mind stream, this will come spontaneously without effort. We will feel in these ways. We will respond in these ways. However, now I have received the inner condition, a perfect human body endowed with 8 freedoms and 10 richnesses. Unfortunately, I can't go through those now, but you can Google them and find what they are, which gives me the ability to achieve all happiness and success. I have also met the outer conditions, a holy Mahayana virtuous friend, such as Kapje Lama Tupten Sobo Rinpoche, His Holiness the 14th Dalai Lama, who is extremely difficult to find but can grant state of omniscience in 1 second, and the teachings of the Buddha, the supreme medicine that dispels all the sufferings of transmigratory beings without exception. If I continue to seek mere temporary happiness for myself and my own liberation from the bondage of the disturbing, unsubdued thoughts and karma, what difference is there between me and a foolish, dumb animal? Such an attitude would be extremely upsetting from both sides. From my own side, how shameless. And from the side of others, how very ungenerous, how selfish and cruel. How dare I cherish myself and renounce others? Aren't other sentient beings the precious ones from whom I have received all happiness and success? It is therefore not enough to merely ensure that I will not be reborn in the suffering lower realms, nor is it enough to simply seek my own freedom from samsara, which is the Hinayana scope and aspiration. All beings have been my mother. There is not a single one who has not been. Moreover, each one has been my mother numberless times, and each time has been just as kind to me as my present mother. This is a very wonderful thought. We have to contemplate this very often. This really helps to generate that love for other sentient beings and care and interest for other sentient beings. Not just seeing them as friend, enemy, stranger, but seeing their kindness despite how they appear in this life. At this very moment, not only are these kind mother sentient beings experiencing great suffering, but they are also running constantly to create the causes of more. There is not even a second when they experience ultimate happiness. If a mother's suffering is not alleviated by her own child, who else will do it? Even though it is up to me alone to bear the burden of eradicating the suffering of all mother sentient beings, at the moment, I am incapable of receiving the suffering of even one sentient being. So this is the Mahayana, the great vehicle, motivation. The scope is that taking the burden of all sentient beings, to liberate all sentient beings onto ourselves, taking that responsibility. And thinking, if I don't, who else will take that responsibility? We can't depend on others. Yet if I achieve the holy body of the Buddha, just one ray of its light would ripen the minds of countless sentient beings, leading them to the blissful state of peace. Therefore, to free all mother sentient beings from sufferings and lead them to the peerless happiness of enlightenment, I must attain Buddhahood. This is not without causes and conditions. Its principal cause is the two bodhicittas. Therefore, I am going to practice the profound oral teaching on transforming the mind into bodhicitta. So in the Vajrayana path, in the Mahayana, we try to generate, we try to accumulate merit as well as wisdom. In the lower vehicle, we just focus on the wisdom, completing the collection of wisdom in order to attain liberation. But in the Mahayana, we accumulate virtue by doing meritorious actions, such as generating bodhicitta and so forth, and engaging in these motivated practices of tantra, mantra recitations, making offerings to visualizations of these deities that then increase our ability to achieve enlightenment. So that's why we're going to engage in this practice. So now I will guide you through the visualization. So from this thought, this motivation, in the space before us, spontaneously arises a vast 1,000-petaled lotus set upon a wide stem. And atop of that is a moon disc lying flat. On top of that is the great compassionate one, Chenrezig. His body, the essence of pure white light, is standing in standing form upon two legs. His body, the nature of pure white light, beautiful, radiant. He has 1,000 arms and 11 faces. His first two arms are folded at his heart, holding a wish-fulfilling jewel, the jewel of bodhicitta. His second right hand, the uppermost, holds a crystal rosary, which purifies the mind. Third right hand is extended downwards, granting sublime realizations. From it, or flows nectar of the enlightened mind, which liberates all the suffering of the lower realms. In his fourth right hand holds a Dharma chakra, Dharma wheel. His second left hand, the uppermost, holds a golden lotus. And the third right hand holds a water vessel, which grants the initiation into the family of Chenrezig, that we become his disciples. And the fourth right hand holds a bow and arrow, which is to defeat all the enemies and foes which hinder and harm sentient beings, defeats all the delusions, the maras. And his remaining 992 hands are spread out, reaching in every direction, and in the palm of each hand is an eye, a Buddha eye, representing the 1,000 Buddhas of this fortunate eon. granting all those eyes grant realizations which alleviate the sufferings of sentient beings. And his principal central face is pure white, beautiful, radiant, with eyes like lotus petals. His right face is green, the left is red. Above those, the central face is green, the right is red, and the left is white. Above those, the central face is red, the right is white, and the left is green. And above those is a wrathful blue-black face of Mahakala, the protector, with a third eye. And he has flames. His hair is like flames flaming upwards. And upon his crown is the peaceful face of Amitabha, the guru of Chinrezig, in Buddha aspect. And he is adorned with many beautiful garments, the precious silks and jewels, symbolizing his realizations and attainments of the highest order. And at the crown of the central white face is a white syllable Om. At the throat, a red R, and at his heart is a blue horn. And at his heart is also a shri syllable. That shri syllable is the root sound of Chinrezig, from which he is born. And it stands upon a moon disc at his heart. And so just reflecting on the form that we visualize before ourselves, we will take refuge in this purely enlightened being, so that we may also become, achieve the same state. So we recite here in English, I take refuge until I'm enlightened in the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Supreme Assembly. By my merits of generosity and so forth, may I become a Buddha to benefit transmigratory beings. I take refuge until I'm enlightened in the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Supreme Assembly. By my merits of generosity and so forth, may I become a Buddha to benefit transmigratory beings. I take refuge until I'm enlightened in the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Supreme Assembly. By my merits of generosity and so forth, may I become a Buddha to benefit transmigratory beings. So now, reflecting on the visualization, keeping that in mind, of Chinrezig, unfortunately, we don't have time to recite all these prayers at this time. So we will go directly to the mantra recitation, the mantra being mind protection. So we will recite the mantra of Chinrezig, which we should think that this mantra is the manifestation in sound of Chinrezig. So when we recite that sound, the vibrations of that sound within our body, in our voice, from that emanates the qualities and the form of Chinrezig, which embodies those qualities. So with the visualization in mind of Chinrezig, we visualize that the shri at his heart, the syllable, seed syllable, which is white, pure white light, and surrounding that are these syllables of the mantra Om money, Padme Hum, surrounding it, and when we recite it, it turns clockwise around the Sri syllable. And then as it does that, the centrifugal force, we can think, emanates all these beams of pure white light, and we can visualize surrounding us numberless sentient beings, starting with our family and friends, behind us, in front of us, those who we see as distant. And then surrounding them are those people we're indifferent to, and every being in the universe without exception. And we can think that the beams of light of Chenrezig go out and touch the mind streams at the crowns. It enters their mind streams and goes through their mental continuum, completely blessing and purifying all the negativities, ignorance, all the negativities of their body, speech, and mind from the past, the present, and the future. And so we recite the mantra a few times and just meditate on that visualization. You can focus on the sound, whichever you're comfortable with doing. So here we're engaging our body, speech, and mind in the practice of virtue and compassion. So just think that light also comes to us from Chenrezig's heart and also blesses through our mental continuum. Padme Hum, Padme Hum, Padme Hum, Padme Hum, Padme Hum, Padme. We just take a few moments, having recited the mantra with the visualization. Just allow it to resonate in our mental, in our minds, in our awareness for a few moments. And just think that and have conviction that this practice and our recitation and our visualization has blessed our mind and our continuum, as well as our voice and our body in this session. not only ourselves, but all the numberless sentient beings have been touched by including them, sending out that energy to them. They will no doubt receive the benefits and the fruits of this practice, if not now, by creating the karmic latencies, the potential in the mind, that in the future, when we achieve enlightenment, we will actualize, and that benefit will manifest. And that by the familiarization of this practice on a daily basis, it will bring us closer, as this session has, to actualizing the state of Chenrezig, who is inseparable from the Buddha, from the mental continuum of the Buddha, and should feel very joyful and grateful for engaging in this practice and for all the others who have joined this session today. There's 15 people in the session. So I think that this session's potential is multiplied by 15, 16 if we include ourselves. Not only that, but all those who will watch this and follow this, engage in this practice through YouTube later, and just feel so joyful about that. How wonderful it is in this world where there seems so much suffering and war and conflict and just think how wonderful that is. Just rejoicing, just thinking how wonderful it is what we've done, what others have done, what the Buddha achieved. It so increases the potential within our mind streams. Unimaginable. And the benefits of reciting the mantra, which I will also request to share the link in the comment, in the description on the YouTube. You can read the meaning of the mantra Om Mani Padme Hum is also very profound and vast. You can also research that. There's many interpretations of the mantra. None of them are incorrect necessarily. But the most simple is that Om Mani Padme Hum is the complete path to enlightenment from beginning to end. And so thank you for joining. And we will just dedicate. So after we rejoice, then we dedicate all the potentials that we've generated through rejoicing. We also dedicate those who will recite this dedication briefly. Sorry to overrun a little bit. So if you have to leave now, then just you may, and you can dedicate in your own way. So due to all the past, present, and future merits collected by me, and all the merits of the three times, past, present, future, collected by the numberless Buddhas and numberless sentient beings, may bodhicitta be generated in the hearts of all the sentient beings of the six realms, and especially in the hearts of everybody in this world, including all the students, benefactors, and volunteers of the FPMT organization. May it be generated in the hearts of all those who rely upon me, all those for whom I have promised to pray, and all those whose names have been given to me, may be generated in the heart and in the hearts of all my family members, those who are living and those who have died. May the bodhicitta that has already been generated increase. Whatever suffering transmigratory beings experience, may it all ripen upon me. Whatever happiness and virtue I accumulate, may it all ripen upon others. May I never be discouraged, even for a moment, from practicing the deeds of the bodhisattvas for the sake of others, by completely renouncing anything done for my own sake, and by engaging in the holy actions of the kind founder, Guru Shakyamuni Buddha. So we can think that after this session, as long as we can for the rest of today, we can think, wow, we're blessed by Chenrezig. We can keep Chenrezig on the crown of our heads. If you received empowerment of Chenrezig, initiation by a Lama, then you can have Chenrezig at your heart. You can even visualize you are Chenrezig yourself. For those who haven't, it's very important you just maintain the thought Chenrezig is on your crown all day with all activities. Then everything you do will benefit sentient beings, because just generating bodhicitta, it said in the scriptures, in the sutras, that just generating bodhicitta for 1 second, just 1 second, or even one moment, which is like a split second, anything you do, is the benefit is multiplied by 100,000 times. Just think of that. Wow, we can just generate that thought for one moment. Pure bodhicitta. I'm talking pure bodhicitta, not contrived bodhicitta. But of course, contrived bodhicitta, effortful bodhicitta also creates benefit. But when we are able to achieve that pure bodhicitta, then wow, everything we do. That's why these lamas, His Holiness the 14th Dalai Lama, is considered a human form of Chenrezig. These enlightened beings, they can manifest in any forms to benefit us. They do manifest in various forms to benefit us, to guide us, to lead us to enlightenment. If these deities appeared in front of us, we would be confused for some people. So they appear in human forms so that we can communicate them with them, we can accept them, we can, you know, we can relate to them. So they benefit us so much. So just think of that. Then finally, due to all the points of this, we're dedicating in emptiness, which is the highest thought of the Mahayana vehicle. It's also a distinct aspect of the Mahayana vehicle of wisdom, which eliminates all the karmic obscurations of omniscience and the Buddhahood, only found in the Mahayana vehicle, their view of emptiness, prasangika. Due to all the past, present, and future merits collected by me, and all the merits of the three times, past, present, future, collected by the numberless Buddhas and numberless sentient beings, which are completely empty of existing from their own side. Means they exist, but they don't exist from their own side. May I, who is completely empty of existing from my own side, I exist, but it's like I don't exist, not in the way that we maintain second to second. Achieve the state of great compassionate one, Chenrezig, Avalokiteshvara, which is completely empty of existing from its own side. Chenrezig doesn't exist from its own side. It's like it doesn't exist at all. But like it doesn't exist, this very subtle existence. And lead all the sentient beings who are completely empty of existing from their own side to that state of great compassionate one, which is completely empty of existing from its own side, by myself alone, where I'm completely empty of existing on my own side. So thank you everyone for joining this session. Sorry, it went a little bit longer over time and we didn't get to complete all the prayers, but most important is the generator, the motivation. We don't have the right motivation, like I said, no matter what practice or prayers we do, they're all kind of, they're meaningless, like a tape recorder. So even we just recited the motivation today, but we just recited the refuge, is most important. Without motivation, then we recite all the prayers, then would have ever had any difference. So, and also recitation of mantra. Okay, thank you. Have a wonderful day. So, like I said, if there are any questions, I will remain online. I'm just going to stop the recording, but you can ask in the chat if you have any questions, or you can open your mic and we can talk. Thank you.